First, I would like to thank the organizers of this conference for inviting me here. I'm very pleased to visit these memorial days and give here a talk dedicated to Nikolai. I collaborated with him about 12 years, and you know, it was a real pleasure for me to work with him, and of course I learned a lot from him in physics, I mean, but also it was just a pleasure to talk to him, and not only about physics. We did, well, maybe more than 10 works together, I don't remember exactly, reviewing some of these papers today, I will mention the results which have been obtained together with Nikolai and with my colleagues from my home institution, Alexey Smakhvalov, Denis Ryzhov, Ilya Shereshevsky, and also with Mike's wife, Ivan Haimovich, and Valery Vinokur from Agro National Laboratory. And one of this picture has been already shown here. It's me with Nikolai in Finland. We collected mushrooms and discussed what is physics. You know, well, and this folder is made in Argonne, which we visited several times, and each time I tried to fit my time of the visit so that to be with him together at the same time, and it was a lot of fun. It's just ring around Argonne, about 15 kilometers where we walked. He was a very good sportsman, me not, but he did this ring very easy. For me it was tough. Well, and this is the plan of my talk, I will start from some sort of introduction, remind you basic properties of the electronic structure for its course. Of course, these issues have been discussed today in the talk by Grigory and some others, but what I'm planning to do is to focus on some other features of the electronic structure, particularly connected with some sort of non-quasi-classical effects in the electron and Hall quantum mechanics inside the cores. And I will briefly review our joint papers with Nikolai on thermal transport along vortex lines, where these non-quasi-classical effects come to play, and also mention some details, important details about the interplay of normal and Andreev reflection inside the core, inside the vortex core. And finally, I'm planning to share with you some thoughts about so-called Majorana states, which have been mentioned today in several talks. And in this part, I mean the part about Majorana, I will present some results of study, which is in fact in progress now. Okay. This is a sort of general slide, which is aimed to show you the vortex line, which is basically the normal core with suppressed order parameter and with a supercurrent which flows around it. And phenomenological description of the vortex state is of course based on the Gisbrook-Landau theorem. And an appropriate equation is shown here, but if we are interested in the case of low temperatures and some microscopic properties, of course Gisbrook-Landau theory is not enough, and we need some sort of microscopic consideration like Bogoliubov-Dejean theory or various kinds of equations for Green's functions. Basically, what we get from this microscopic description is the size quantization of electron motion inside the core. And here I just show you the potential well, which is formed by the suppressed gap inside the vortex core and energy levels of electrons and holes. In fact, this figure is misleading because we know that the potential for electronic motion inside the core is off-diagonal. And so it's not standard Schrödinger quantum mechanics. And this means that the reflection at the core boundary is unwave reflection. And so there is an important physical difference between this situation. Nevertheless, if we forget about this very important things, we still can get simple estimate of the interlevel distance for electrons inside the core, which is given here. It's just estimate from Schrödinger quantum mechanics. And this is correct because this is the gap value divided by the Fermi momentum times coherence length. This is basically a very large parameter, and because of that, the interlevel distance is small in most of superconductors. And these are STM vortex images. STM is supposed to measure the electronic density of states, and because of this, it's a sort of confirmation that indeed inside the core we have localized electronic and hole states. And some brief information about the theory of electrons inside the core. A very important thing is, from the point of theory, is quasi-classical approximation in this problem. The same as in many problems in superconductors. The point is that the coherence length in most of superconducting compounds is much, much larger than the Fermi wavelength, and because of that, we can forget about two-dimensional quantum, or three-dimensional quantum mechanics inside vortex core. This is vortex core, shown by gray color, and just consider one-dimensional quantum mechanics along some set of trajectories, like in VKB approximation, yeah? And solve appropriate Andreev equations along the trajectories, obtain the spectrum. And after that, there is some sort of correct procedure which allows to restore the true quantum mechanical spectrum from the solution of these one-dimensional problems. If we focus on this one-dimensional problem along a certain trajectory shown by this red color, which passes through the vortex core, it's important to note here that the phase of the superconducting gap, namely this theta, it changed from 0 to pi. And because of that, we have a bound state, yeah, a fermionic bound state. And provided we exactly cross the vortex core passing through the vortex center, there is exact solution. And if we just shift trajectory, then we can build some reasonable approximation. And at this picture, I would like to illustrate the well-known Kalinijan matrix solution, which is built, in fact, in the same way like I have shown you. And this is the so-called anomalous spectral branch, namely energy as a function of the angular momentum of quasi-particles. Or in other words, this mu is just an impact parameter of the trajectory passing through the core. This anomalous branch goes from minus delta to plus delta and crosses Fermi level. So these states are important, as it has been already mentioned today, for many experimental, in many experimental respects, in particular, it was told about vortex dynamics, which is indeed strongly defined by the peculiarities of these states inside the core. Also, for the local density of states, here you can see a figure which may be a perfect figure which illustrates the presence of the zero bias anomaly in the STM spectra. This is the IDV curve as a function of voltage obtained by scanning tunneling microscopy. This is, in fact, the signature of these bound states. And also an important thing is that these bound states play the role in transport, in thermal transport, in particular along magnetic field. Okay, so let me skip this slide. I have already talked about this. About non-quasi-classical effect. Certainly, one of the obvious non-quasi-classical effects is quantization of these levels. And where does it come from? This is this trajectory, quasi-classical trajectory inside the core. And the important point is that because of this superfluid velocity, there is no exact backscattering. And because of that, the trajectory starts to rotate inside the core. And here's a simple estimate of the speed of this angular rotation of the trajectory. And this is this expression. And this speed appears to be determined by the mini-gap omega. Okay, so if we now keep in mind a standard commutation relation between the angular momentum operator and angle of the trajectory orientation, we immediately get Borzammerfeld quantization rule, which determines the quantization of levels. And in standard superconductors, like S-wave superconductors, this beta value is 1/2, and because of that, we do not have level exactly at zero energy. Yeah? There is a mini gap. This is not the case for these Majorana and fermions. I will tell about this later. And this is the spectrum as a function of the momentum along the vortex axis, kz. You see that you have these mini bands. Okay, thermal transport. Very briefly. Yeah? Provided we mean exact backscattering of trajectories and real backscattering, then it's easy to see that in the clean limit, there is no transport along the vortex core, because these electrons are exactly backscattered as holes. And this means that there is no velocity in this direction. Yeah? You can get it very easy if you just estimate the group velocity of these Kalinijan matrix states, and you get a value which is much, much less than Fermi velocity. And because of this, thermal conductance, K, appears to be strongly suppressed in comparing to standard, well, I would say, Charlene conductance value, yeah? Of course, I'm speaking not about electrical, but thermal transport, yeah? And because of that, the value of thermal conductance appears to be well below of this quantity. This is the normal state conductance. This is magnetic field divided by HC2, which is in fact observed experimentally. And what can restore? Well, just 1 minute. You can easily obtain this estimate, well, confirm this estimate by exact calculations using a sort of Landauer approach for transport of quasi-particles along the vortex line. You can obtain from Bogoliubov-Dezhen equations this simple identity for the group velocity of excitations, and then calculate the thermal conductance, which is very much similar to Landauer expression for a while. What can stimulate thermal transport? Of course, impurities. Yeah? If we now add impurities in our sample, this means that the trajectory of electron, shown here by red color, it will not be backscattered, It will just scatter a certain impurity, and because of that, there appears some motion of quasi-particles along the vortex. So this is the motion along the vortex core. And in fact, this observation results in a very important thing. As soon as we increase the mean free path, we get decay of thermal conductivity. It's unusual, but this is true. And the total picture of thermal conductance as a function of mean free path is shown here. First, we have some sort of standard increase in the delta limit, then this decay, which I explained to you. And after that, we again have some sort of increase, which corresponds to the diffusion with the group velocity. And because of that, we can obtain very interesting region, some sort of reinterpretation in thermal conductivity behavior. Probably because of lack of the time, I will skip the part with normal reflection of quasi-particles at various defects inside vortex core, and I will go to Majorana part. In fact, when we worked with Nikolai, in many problems we were interested in the existence of zero energy modes, yeah? And in particular, we met with the problem of these modes in graphene with induced superconductivity, and we worked made together with Ivan, yes? And obviously, this interest was strong. And recently, you can see that this question of the existence of zero energy modes in vortices and edge states, it's somewhat in the focus of many, many papers. Let's consider a standard Bogoliubov-Dezhen theory written here. It's a rather general case. Yeah? This is the gap operator. I put here this integral because generally gap depends on two coordinates. Yeah? This U and V are electron and hole-like parts of the wave function. Basically, what we know from general theory is that there are two cases for the gap behavior, singlet pairing and triplet pairing. For singlet pairing, the order parameter can be written in this form. Yeah? This sigma y is spin degree of freedom, yeah? And this is orbital degree of freedom. And because these are fermions, it's clear that this function d is symmetric with respect to the change of variables. Yeah? R1 and R2. There is a very important property of Bogoliubov-Dezhen equations, which can be easily observed if we change energy to minus energy. And this transformation is shown here. If you have a certain energy level UV with function UV, when you go to negative energy minus C, you should transform wave functions like this. Yeah? For the triplet pairing, the transformation is a little bit different. And the difference is that there is no this sign minus. This is very important. For the triplet pairing, the structure of the order parameter is different, of course. And this orbital part should be antisymmetric. Because of these different properties of transformation from positive to negative energies, we can have different structure of quasi-particle spectrum. Let's have a look. For singlet pairing, we always should have pairs of levels. Yeah? And if a certain level appears to be close to zero energy to the Fermi level, this means that immediately another level should be also close to this Fermi level. And the only possibility for this to satisfy this transformation is to assume that this transformation it's responsible for transformation between two different states. We cannot assume that this property at zero energy corresponds to a single state. It's impossible because of this sign minus. Yeah? We cannot satisfy it for a single state. This means that necessary in the single case we have two levels at zero energy if they exist. Yeah? For the triplet pairing, the story is completely different. Because of the different transformation properties, there is a possibility to have a level at Fermi energy only one level. And let's have a look. It's clear because we can just put here equality sign. Yeah? And this can be realized. And in fact, it is what people call Majorana fermions. Because if we now consider the Bogoliubov transformation of the operators, of standard electronic operators, which allow us to diagonalize Hamiltonian, this means that the creation operator appears to be equal to annihilation operator. And these are Majorana fermions. In singlet pairing, it's impossible to get this. Never. But next point is that if we have a close look at this case, it's clear that such operators cannot be obtained by means of standard Bogoliubov transformation. Because this transformation is canonical. And thus, we cannot change statistics. Majorana fermions are not fermions at all. If you get fermionic commutation relations, you immediately get contradiction. You cannot put this in fermionic relations. What's the solution of this obvious paradox? Yeah? Usually people say that in fact we always have two Majorana fermions in the set. And this is of course true. Because for instance, if these Majorana fermions are realized in vortex cores, I mean that the vortex core level is exactly at the Fermi level, one of them, yeah? Then you can have two vortices. Or for instance, if you have one vortex in a sample, you always have sample boundary, and so you have Majorana fermion at the edge. And this is of course true. The only point is that somehow this property, the importance of the presence of two Majorana fermions, appears to be important even if the distance between these Majoranas are very, very large. So we can assume that one of them is in Moscow and another one here. And this is of course bad, because definitely the wave function decays exponentially, and it's very strange that to have, well, Majorana fermionic state here, we need to have another Majorana in Moscow. Yeah? How to solve all these? Let's have a look at the cup function equation. The important point is that to solve the equation of superconductivity, basically it's not enough to find the functions of electrons and holes, because these equations are in fact strongly nonlinear, because we have in addition the equation for delta. Usually, in many cases, we forget about this at all, because we say, okay, it doesn't depend on particular form of delta, it's only symmetry which matters, and so let's take it, well, somehow approximately, yeah? Let's have a look. This is self-consistent equation, and it is obvious that when calculating the contribution to this equation, to this its right part, from the Majorana states, we immediately obtain very, very strong thing. Look, because of this property of Majorana states, that the conjugate equals to U, we get this expression, and you can easily see that it's symmetric with respect to the change of variables R1 and R2. And this means that this function, this orbital function, is even. But let's remind that our starting point, is that the gap function is odd. How to do with this? How to live with this, yeah? On the one hand, you can immediately say, okay, this is all rubbish, because here you have this tangents, and this is the energy of Majorana states, which is zero. Because of that, this term just doesn't contribute to the gap equation at all. On the other hand, we want to consider two mirrors, and it's important for us, as I mentioned to you at the previous figure, yeah? And this means that there will be slight shift from zero energy because of the overlapping of the wave function. Of course, if they are at infinity, this E equals to zero. But at any finite distance, it's not zero. So this is bad, because superconductor which doesn't satisfy self-consistency equation, it means that we just do not have minimum of the free energy. In other words, it cannot be stable. Let me remind you that the breakdown of the self-consistent equations means that the divergence of the supercurrent is not zero. For instance, if we take the Kitaev string, it means that if we have this Majorana states at the edge, then there is no zero divergence of the current. And this is, of course, bad. How to move further? Yeah? Move further, I mean that we need to understand if there is an instability in a superconducting state, how should it develop? What should happen? And let's try to see what should happen taking two vortices in P-wave superconductor as an example, yeah? This is a general expression for the supercurrent through the functions U and V. And let's solve the following problem. Let's take one vortice and take a superflow which goes around it, yeah? This means that we fix some sort, vector potential, some external vector potential. And let's calculate the response of this current to this external vector potential, which is applied to a vortex. And doing this, we see that there are two paths. One of them is diamagnetic, and another one is paramagnetic. And if there are a zero energy state, this paramagnetic path appears to be huge inside the core. This means that the current, external current, which flows around the core, this current may be created by another vortex, yeah? It changed its direction. And this means that if we, let me go here. If we consider two vortices with the same vorticity, they can be attracted to each other because the current changed its direction. Let me return back. Basically, this problem of the inverse sign in the London relation between the current and vector potential has been already known for several years. An example which people discussed a lot is the inverse of this sign in ferromagnet superconducting structures because of the odd frequency pair, so-called odd frequency pair. Yeah? And what we know is that the change of this sign can change the instability in the systems, in the system's superconductor ferromagnet. And an obvious wish, an obvious thing is to try to find this instability here. Okay, so now if you have some disk and there is a vortex, there is an image anti-vortex, then usually they attract to each other. But here they should, the interaction should be repulsive at certain distances. And this means that we can get spontaneous vortex state. The vortices in this state should be organized in pairs because, of course, at small distances there is repulsion. And at large distances, attraction. Because of this, there should exist some energetic favorable distance. In the case of one dimension, the analog of this spontaneous vortex state should be organized like follows. We can expect the just step-like behavior of the gap function, which restores the necessary symmetry of the gap function. This is a sort of final picture. Final picture. So instability of superconducting state in the presence of Majorana fermions. And here I plotted these arrows, which show some sort of important relations between this and this, this and this. In fact, the relation between odd frequency pairing and paramagnetic Meissner relation has been already noted previously in particularly in delta limits, in delta limit by in papers by Tanaka, Golubov, and Asana and their co-authors. What I'm going to say now is that this change in the sign of the Meissner relation can result in instability of the superconducting state. And this instability will develop till the vortices will be so close to each other that these symmetric properties of the U and V wave functions will disappear at all. And because of that, we'll get possibility to satisfy the self-consistency equation. One final remark, I already finished. When this happened, this is one vortex core, yeah, and this is another vortex core. How we get Majorana state using Boltzmann-Herzberg quantization rule? We have trajectory which precesses inside the core, making the angle 2 pi. And because of that, we get this Majorana state. What happens if we have another vortex which is rather close? It means that when this trajectory is somewhere here, the wave function can tunnel here. And because of that, we can have some sort of this situation of distribution of trajectories. This will give us absolutely different result of Boltzmann-Herzberg quantization rule. And this means that vortices are strongly bounded by quasi-particle tunneling. We solved this problem with Mike Silaev a few years ago, and we did get that transformation of spectrum is very strong. So I think that the typical distances of vortices between vortices in this spontaneous phase will be determined by this tunneling process. Thank you.
Yes.
Well, I have a question about this instability that you discussed. As Tanakh and others discussed in their papers, in principle, you can interpret zero energy states in vortex cores as a result of appearance of some small fraction of odd frequency component.
Exactly.
But that's anyway a small fraction on the background of conventional diamagnetic state. So in this case,
yeah, that's true. But if you consider discrete levels, and if you take low temperatures, yeah, less than omega naught, and if you, because of that, you can take in paramagnetic response only one level, which is exactly at zero, you get this increase in paramagnetic response, which will result in the inverse of the sign of the current around the core. This is the point.
Can you separate this contribution from the conventional diamagnetic one?
Well, diamagnetic response, total diamagnetic response is no. We can calculate, just concentration of all carriers at zero temperature. It's just full contribution, and it appears to be smaller, locally, of course. Of course, locally. So,
yes, it compensate good in defense of my own opinion.
I think this contribution from the Majorana fermion is not written very accurately in what you wrote. So what you are saying is that I had a Majorana fermion, it had zero energy, it was an exact quasi particle, and it had conjugate U and V. Then you turn on very little splitting and say that now your tangent is non-zero, while U and V are experience small corrections. I think as soon as you have the splitting, you should immediately switch to the exact eigenstates, which are now the sum or difference between the two Majoranas.
I got it. Yeah, let's have a look.
Absolutely.
I have answer. This is wave function at one vortex. This is wave function at another. So what we do, what we can do at large distances. Well, this is large, you can do tight-binding consideration, tight-binding approximation. This means that we construct just sum of these two wave functions, of course, U and V, yes, simultaneously. And each of this contribution, well, let's write it. Each of these contributions possesses Majorana properties, symmetry, that symmetry which I mentioned, yeah? Which is bad for the symmetry of the wave function. Now you will substitute this into the self-consistent equations. And look, the wave functions which are centered at this vortex, their explanation is not here. And they cannot change the fact of the broken odd symmetry of the gap function. The exponential is small compared to the main part, which has wrong symmetry. This is unfortunately.
No, you can do this exactly, and you will find that there is no problem.
Yeah, this I do. I do it exactly. Look, it's exact. It's exponential is small here.
It's tight
this
binding.
One. Tight binding. Well, of course, if I. The important point is that what I only need is to consider it in tight-binding approximation. Because if the distance is small and the tunneling is strong, as I just told you before this, at the previous figure, the wave functions are strongly hybridized, and the property, this bad symmetry property of the wave function, which destroys the self-consistent equation, it disappears. And this is good. You know?
Yes.
You have mentioned that when vortices attract each other, they form pairs. Why not lattice?
in fact, to say the truth, if you fix, if you assume this potential with part of attraction and part of repulsion, the structure of resulting vortex state is a tricky thing. In fact, it depends on the geometry of the samples and other things. There may be clusters. There may be some sort of deformed lattice. It depends on concentration, or on the geometry, on the demagnetization factor. In fact, this problem with some sort of model interaction potential, it has been considered in several papers before, because some this potential, it appears not only because Majorana, yeah? In many problems in superconductors, for instance, in superconductor ferromagnet superlattices, you can get this potential. You can get this potential if you consider superconductor with two order parameter components. Well, a lot of people know this, not necessary pairs. My answer is that you are right and I'm wrong. Not necessary pairs.
But look, if you know, change the electric charge of the electron one to zero, then the neutral liquid superfluid 3, then you will have no instability because there is no currents.
Very good question. You asked me, and I thought about it. I'm not quite sure about neutral case, but what I think is that, of course, if you have no charge, there is no this vector potential which elongates the current and so on. Yeah, but still, you have some relation between the flow of particles, yeah, and the gradient of phase. And this coefficient here can change its size.
No.
It can. And this means instability.
Due to single level.
Yes. Let's have a look. I'm speaking about this functional effect. Let's just kill A here. Forget it. No way. And this means that no charge. And this lambda large can change its sign. And this means instability. If it happens locally, then there is of course a question if the instability happens or not. It's a problem which we need to solve. My next argument in the case of vortices, only in the case of vortices, yeah? Please, I think only about vortices at this point, is that one vortex creates flow at the point of location of another vortices, and the current is inversed. And this means that there should be an opposite direction of the force, of interaction. And please, keep in mind another important argument. It's not only a question of the change of sign in this relation. Again, if you have Majorana, you break the self-consistency equation. It's important because you break symmetry of self-consistent equation. And this is the key point. All these things are just a sort of consequence of this.
Instability with respect to which kind of decay? With respect to what?
In the case of vortices, if you have Majorana fermions and vortices, it means that the vortices attract to each other at large distances and they come closer. And the distance between them will decrease till the moment, well, the Majorana symmetry properties of these fermions, which I showed you, it will disappear. And you will get possibility to restore the gap equation. Because this argument, which I told to Pavel, yeah, that in this mixture, the contribution of this state here is exponentially small, will not work. If they are close, it will not work, of course. At rather small distances, it will be wrong.
Okay. And the energy will be lower.
Huh?
The energy will be lower after the decay.
The energy will be lower, yeah. Yeah. This is what I say. If you cannot meet the self-consistent equation, it's usual thing. Many functions do not meet self-consistent equation. It just means that you do not have minimum free energy, that's it. Many functions. You can take many functions and they will not satisfy self-consistent equation. You still can have U and V for them. But it doesn't mean that they are solution of Bogoliubov theory.
So it's just an excited state of the system?
No, it's not excited state. You look, if you fix delta, gap potential, and you find U and V solutions of Bogoliubov-Degen equations, well, I Well, it's just some sort of eigenvalue problem, yeah? It's here, yeah? You can solve it for some fixed delta potential, yeah? You get excitations, well, with different energies. You get everything. But does these excitations relate somehow to the superconducting state, truth equation? It's not obvious, because before saying this, you need to satisfy a self-consistent equation. You need to build data starting from these ULV functions. After that, when you check this, when you check that it's correct, delta is correct, then you can proceed. But if not, then you should change delta. In our case, it means that you should change delta in such a way so to make the vortices closer. Because it's change of delta when you move them close to each other.
Okay, let's stop this anti-Majorana. Okay, thank you again.
Thank you.
First of all, maybe somebody wants to say a few words. Some confusion, right?
No. Let me just мы кончили сегодня этот день памяти Коли Куприна. Вот, естественно, у каждого о нем свои персональные воспоминания. Он был очень теплый и скромный человек. Вот, но даже те, у кого их нет, конечно же, он останется в науке, ну, на конференции доказательств. Походу это так, он был великий, конечно. Человек решил массу задач, вот, но всегда, он будет всегда вместе с ним.
Если никто больше ничего не хочет сказать. Спасибо.